So, good morning, everyone. Actually, it's good afternoon. My name is Ryan. I think a lot of athletes are here in the room, and you know me as a nutrition coach. So, how many of you have had breakfast this morning? Just raise your hand. Okay, all of you have had breakfast. How many of you in this room are athletes? Please raise your hand. Athletes. How many of you are athletes in this room? So about 50% are athletes. Okay, keep your hand down. If you agree with me, do you think nutrition is very important as support to an athlete? Yes or no? If you say yes, raise your hand. Is nutrition important? Okay. Now, it's very, very simple. I'm here to speak on the support structure. The Indian Olympic team in any sport doesn't have a nutritionist. Any sport passe. Sapad, Uta is cultural. It's not scientific. So the simplest thing, I wrote a huge thing. There's no point. People get bored. There's only one thing I will tell you, working with Olympic medalist Sushil Kumar. He invested on his own in his nutrition, his supplementation, and he said to all the other things that in life, let me do this on my own, because I will speak only for nutrition. You train once or twice a day, you sleep once or twice a day, you will potty once or twice a day as an athlete, but you will need to eat 7 to 8 times a day. That's the first issue. Second, we're not having enough of knowledge of what to eat, when to eat, how much to eat. So the support system is failing at two levels. It's failing at the grassroots level, it's at the school level, the parent level, where they feel that I ate 2 eggs also, so you also eat 2 eggs. So I don't want to embarrass any parent in here, but I can point out 4 or 5 of my clients here, the rest do not know nutrition. But everyone wants to buy the 10,000 rupee shoe, the 50,000 rupee racket. So it is not the equipment. And an Olympian sitting here will say the same to me. And every Olympian I met said, if we had nutrition, maybe we would have gotten a second more. And you look at Cristiano Ronaldo, he has his own personal chef, nutritionist. So one support structure, if government can hear and if this is being documented, the food that has been fed to the athlete is designed by a caterer. A caterer is working on profitability model. Profitability model means I will buy the cheapest food to get the maximum return. Do you think an athlete needs the cheapest food or the most expensive food? Think about it. The rice you buy, the eggs you eat, if they are not organic, athletes, when they go abroad, they actually perform better because the food they get abroad is for 2-3 months is without chemicals. Whereas here, if you eat in any body, any canteen, it's made with the cheapest quality ingredients. You don't need the government to help you. You just need to know, what am I buying from my local shop? And what do I need to take of that amount? How much and when? And then once you start doing this, you start working with nutritionists. Final point. 100 days before Rio Olympics, government released a lot of money. Everyone from the foundations and the government started landing at my QUA Nutrition Clinic. In 100 days, nothing can happen. Only your skin will get better. So when you go for the Olympics, if you start nutrition 100 days in advance, your skin will look good, but you'll not win any medals. Nutrition starts 500 days in advance. The mitochondria, and ask any coach, can you become an Olympian in 100 days? It's years of training, but your nutrition is still cultural. It's made with mummy's love and culture, dadima's love and culture, and maybe if you're an athlete who got married, then it's the wife's culture. But there's no science. So that's where I would leave the entire audience. It's not the facility, it's not the equipment, it's not the shoes. How are you eating your sapad? Uta. That's it.
Mr. Ryan, I agree to your point, like, you know, nutrition is the best. But let's talk about the grassroots talent. When the grassroots talent is really getting into any sport, they don't get into it like, you know, they are going to achieve something. It's just that they have a passion and they're getting into it. At this stage, how do we talk to them about nutrition?
Very simple. We need to develop camps. So whoever's supporting the grassroots initiative, one is identification of talent.
Okay.
From a support point of view as a nutritionist, you have something known as nutrition gene testing and sports gene testing.
Okay.
So the coaches are very good at identifying good talent. Somebody runs very fast. Somebody's able to, the gentleman earlier said somebody was flipping and doing flips into the local river or whatever. Once you identify that talent, people like me can go down to the grassroots level, nutritionists, dietitians, and look at basic things like millets, rice, protein, dals, and at least bring about a feeding program to such children so that they don't only get the best sports training, but they get the good equipment. And I must compliment this part of the world, the school day feeding program.
Correct.
Is brilliant. It's got a National Geographic program. So if we can do that for our school children to incentivize them to come to school to study, imagine if we just had another foundation doing it for sports performance via food. So I think only thing I would say, we need to give little education, maybe make some videos in Kannada, make some videos in local languages in Hindi, which are, you know, everybody today has a mobile phone, even in the rural areas. So if we can make 10-15 minute videos on what to eat and how to eat, I think this would be a nice support structure that we can develop for identification and support of rural talent.
Oh, okay. This is for the rural people, but you know, there is a different kind of problem with the urban people. I think it is too much of knowledge. And at the same time, it is not the right knowledge. I think it's a very bad combination there. You know, like many parents, I mean, I would take even my example, since we have never had it 10 years before. Whatever we used to get it, you know, like, oh, this person is eating this, okay, I should also take this. I should give it to my children. Maybe it will not be correct for my children, their genetic makeup or for that. Now, do you think this nutrition is all based somewhere genetically, or is it the physical makeup, or is it particular to a race?
Complete genetics.
It is complete genetics.
So I'll give you an example. I had Sandeep Sejwal, who was in one of India's fastest breaststrokers.
Yes, yes.
Really good champion. So I did his gene test and he came back as gluten intolerant. Okay, now he's from the north of India, which is the wheat basket.
Wheat basket.
So his mom was shocked that I had to tell him to stop eating chapatis. So, you know, the point is, nothing's wrong with me. But in sports people, you have to look at every bite of nutrition you take. Is it enhancing your performance by 2%? So very simple. If you take wheat and your body doesn't agree with it, it's using 10 other systems to reprocess that wheat. Those 10 systems require that much more energy, which you could have saved for recovery.
Okay.
So this is where science is advancing, and that's what Mr. Nihar Amin said earlier. Even the university and school high performance centers do not match the best in our country. So genetics play a huge factor in the way you eat. So you'll have people going into centers where they are vegetarians all their life. Okay.
Okay,
and I've had Marwadi clients come in and the gene is saying that they can't eat wheat and they can't have milk. So basically vegans. Now, how do I find a protein source? So our culture defines us, our religion defines us for the last 200-300 years.
Yes, correct.
But genetics is about 10,000 years of evolvement. So that's the
So
crux.
Basically you mean to say nutrition will be mainly based on genetic makeup?
It is completely based on genetics, because if you're looking for performance, ma'am, what you're trying to say is that everybody in this room, barring the Olympic level guys, we're all like Maruti 800 to Honda City. Fuel dalte. So, you know, this one blueprint that comes, mommy gives a blueprint, daddy ma gives a blueprint, we follow that. When you start racing this vehicle, that's when I think people should start opening the eyes and say, what should I feed my child? How should I feed my child? And earlier, 10 years ago, I used to use blood test. I thought, oh, blood test, very big. Now, 5 years ago, we started using genetic tests. People are coming. My own in-laws are doctors. They're saying, hey, this is all rubbish. But a simple test that says you're lactose intolerant, what every Indian mother tells you? Doodh pilo. If the child is lactose intolerant, you change from doodh to curd, no? Nee, curd achha nahi. Ayurveda bol raha hai ki curd to cold season mein nahi dene ka hai. With due respect to Ayurveda and due respect to our religious scripts, due respect to my Bible from 20,000 years or wherever it is, there's science today. People need to open up their eyes. The West is winning medals on science, not on hearsay. So look at science, look at experts, look at this structure. And people say this, na, government support nahi deta hai. Government's giving a lot of support. People's intention to win has to start in the home. That's very important.